gardeners, welcome back to another video on my channel. My name is Trisha and we are joined by Metamora, my green tree python. I just wanted to take her out just to show you guys for 1 second. She is on her perch and I don't want to take her off and stress her out. So we're going to talk about green tree python common mistakes that owners make, and I'm going to go ahead and put her back. I just don't want to take her out for the entire video, but I did want to get you guys a little glimpse of her because she is stunning. All right guys, so we are going to jump into it and I'm like dying right now because it's so cute. You can see Chacho in the corner. Right? I cannot point because of the camera, but there he is and he's super adorable. So we're going to jump right in and talk about green tree pythons and the common mistakes that people make while keeping them. These animals are absolutely not for beginners. I'm still learning so much with mine as time goes on, and I've learned so much since I actually got Metamora. I think I've had her for almost, actually it's about 2 years now exactly. I'm really, really bad with time. It's ridiculous. But yeah, I've learned so much and some of these mistakes are things that I have learned from. So I want to share it with you guys and hopefully you guys can learn something. So the number one common mistake that people make with green tree pythons is the improper humidity level. So if you look up the humidity level for green tree pythons on different care sheets, there's like different variances. So like one website will say it's 40 to 70%, another one will say 50 to 70%, another one will say that you want it between 80 and 100%. So it can get a little bit confusing, and the main mistake that people make is not having too low of a humidity, but they actually overdo it with their green tree python to the point where the substrate is completely wet, and that's not something you want. You want the substrate to be moist and lock in humidity, but you don't want it to be overly wet and humid in the enclosure because a lot of bacteria will grow and the water bowl will get slimy and it'll just not be a healthy environment for your green tree python. So with Metamora, I like to keep her between 50 and 70% during the day. I mist her enclosure down and that really spikes up the humidity to 80% every single morning. At nighttime, it's usually around 80 to 90% humidity and that will decrease over time, but because there's no light bulb on, it lasts longer at nighttime, keeping that humidity level up for her. You do want a little bit of a dry period during the day just so that way the substrate isn't overly moist and it's not going to be too much humidity for your animal. That way there's bacteria growing in the enclosure. The lowest I go in my enclosure for Metamora is a 50% during the day, and that is the dry period. The second mistake that people make with green tree pythons is that they just handle them too much. So this does depend on the individual snake and how tolerant they are of handling. You of course never want to overstress your animal out, but these animals are definitely more of an observing animal than a handling, hands-on type of animal. So they're gorgeous and they're stunning to look at, and that's the main appeal for getting these guys. But a lot of people think that because they're very tolerant of handling, they like to take them out quite often, and that's not really the best choice for these guys. I try to leave Metamora alone unless I need to take her out to do cleaning or something like that, but typically I don't take her out much at all. There was like maybe a couple of times when I was going in her enclosure at nighttime and she just wanted to come out onto me. It's a very rare occasion that that does happen, but it does happen for some snakes. Some of them, they each have their own personalities and they're each their own individual. So if yours does like to come out more often, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. But you should never force them to come out and try to force handling on them frequently because it will stress them out. Which leads me to number three, and that is pulling your snake off of its perch. So green tree pythons are very fragile and delicate animals, especially their tails and especially the babies. So the way that they coil themselves around the perch, it's very dangerous to try and rip them off of the perch because that tail is going to be completely coiled around it. And if you jerk their tail, you can really damage their spine. So it's very important to just be very respectful of these animals. Most of the time, they aren't even going to let you try to pull them off. They will just snip and bite at you because they're protecting themselves as they should. So it's just something to be aware of, and that's one thing to respect them with, and just never try to just aggressively pull them off of their perch. Number four is reaching over your green tree python. And this sounds so random, but I've mentioned it before with chameleons and basically a lot of arboreal species, they do not like having things above them. So if you're reaching into their enclosure, going above their head, they're gonna see you as a predator. They're gonna automatically go into a defensive state. They're gonna be stressed, and that's not a situation that you wanna put your snake in. So if you do need to reach into the enclosure or do something, the best thing to do is go underneath of them or just completely leave them alone. Do not ever reach over their head because they're most likely not gonna like it. Number five is poking and prodding them. So a lot of these that I'm bringing up today are basically ways that people try to get their green tray pythons off of their perches when they're trying to get them out of their enclosure. And this is something that I've learned in the past too, because I did not always have removable perches. They're actually pretty new to my setup, which makes everything so much easier, and it just brings her stress levels down because I don't have to try and get her off of a perch. What I used to do is poke and prod her with a snake hook, try to get her to loosen her tail and get off of the perch. That way I can remove her from the enclosure. She would get very stressed out when I did this. She has gotten a little bit defensive doing this as well, and she just gets very, very stressed. So it's not something that I like to see happen. And that's why I just use the removable perches instead. If I have to get her out of the enclosure, then she can just stay comfortable. She can explore if she wants to, but it's all on her own terms and she's in control, which reduces her stress levels. Number six is a lack of light. So this does depend on how you're keeping your green tree python. There are many different ways to keep green tree pythons. Some people like to do it in tubs, and when people are keeping them in tubs, a lot of the time they will use a heat mat rather than a light bulb or heat projector. And while doing this, they may not be exposing their snake to natural daylight. Again, it depends on where they have them in their house. So there are just different things that go into this, but if you have your snake and it has the proper heat, but it's not getting any light within the enclosure to have a proper day and night cycle, then that's a mistake. You do want to make sure that your snake knows when it's daytime and knows when it's nighttime, because it's very important for their overall well-being. They do sleep during the day and then they're very active at nighttime, and without that schedule, they're just going to be off and it will be confusing for them. And it's just really important to make sure that they get that day-night cycle. The seventh mistake with green tree pythons is overfeeding them. So the baby should eat once a week, but when they mature, it's best to feed them every 2 weeks. They really do not eat as often as a lot of other snakes, and that's because they have a much slower metabolism. So because of that, you do want to make sure that you're just not overdoing it with these guys. They do need more time to digest, and they just do not eat as often. They aren't the most active snakes either, so it's just something to keep in mind. They do have skinnier, lankier bodies as well. So like compared to like a ball python, they have much thicker bodies. So people think they need to really thicken up their green tree pythons as well. And that's not really something that is natural for them. They're just naturally a skinnier type of a snake. As long as they're still eating and healthy, that's perfect. You just want to make sure that you're not overdoing it. Typically with an adult, again, you're just going to be doing it every 2 weeks. So the eighth mistake with green tree pythons is the improper temperature for the enclosure. So when it comes to the temperature for a green tree python, you do want them to have a hot spot with a range of 84 to 88 degrees. And then you can have an ambient temperature that goes down to 75 degrees. So I'm talking Fahrenheit, by the way. This is not Celsius. So it's important to make sure there are different variants throughout the enclosure. Providing different types of perches and different spaces, I use my temp gun and check and make sure that there is like a lot of variety in temperatures throughout the enclosure for my snake to pick what she wants. She usually sits around 84 to 85 degrees. My green tree python in particular does not prefer really, really warm temperatures. Green tree pythons are prone to heat stress, so that's something that you want to avoid. I've noticed with Metamora that she likes to sit around 84 to 85 degrees. She doesn't really like anything much more than that. She does have the opportunity. She can scooch over to the left and get a little bit more heat, but she always stays in that vicinity. So that's something that I have noticed with mine in particular. I did experience like a couple of times when it was springtime and it was warming up. I didn't have the AC on in the house and I would open the windows, and this room does get a lot of light, and it would get a little bit too warm in here. And on those couple of days, she would actually go onto the ground because she was having heat stress. So that's something to really pay attention to, because I had to make sure that I lowered the whole temps of the entire room and turn her heat bulb off if necessary to make sure that she was in the proper temperatures, because you don't want your snake to suffer from heat stress. That's awful for them. And another thing to pay attention to is if they don't get the proper temperature, they can also suffer from regurgitation, and they do have a slower metabolism, so they do need the proper amount of heat in order to properly digest their food. At nighttime, they can handle a drop of 65 to 70 degrees Fahrenheit. My room is typically around like 70 to 73 degrees always, so that's pretty much what I keep my temps at night as well. And then of course, I turn the light off at nighttime too. She does not have a light on 24 hours a day. I turn the light on for 12 hours a day, and then 12 hours at night, she has it off. So that is when she would experience that drop in temperature. The ninth mistake is probably the most common that I see with green tree pythons, and it's another thing that I learned as I was going with this, and it's that people have really tall enclosures that are narrow for green tree pythons that don't have a lot of horizontal space. These snakes are arboreal, meaning that they live up in the trees, so it makes sense that you would expect for them to have a lot of vertical space. However, when you're keeping them in captivity, they actually utilize a lot more of horizontal space within their enclosures, especially at nighttime when they're active. So for babies, a lot of people keep them in a 12 by 12 by 18. You can also keep them in a tub. That's what I did. And then for an adult, it's recommended to at least have a 24 by 18 by 24. But honestly, the bigger, the better. And right now I have Metamora. She's 2 years old, but she's still small. They are pretty slow growers. She has a 24 by 24 by 24 enclosure right now, and it is extremely spacious for her. She utilizes every inch of that entire enclosure. So I'm actually thinking that when she gets larger, I will probably get her another upgrade and give her even more space as she grows. And the 10th mistake is another thing that I learned from as well. So, and that is the wrong perch size. So it's important to make sure that when you are picking out a perch for your green tree python, that it is as thick as your snake is in girth. So it's similar to like feeding a rodent to your snake. You want to make sure it's the same size and girth. You want to do the same thing for your green tree python. So a lot of the times when people have babies, they put them on perches that are much too large for them, and it makes it harder for them to digest their food. And this was a mistake that I made because I had no idea when I got Metamora, and I gave her way too thick of a perch. So I was able to switch that out, and I learned from it, and I was able to improve from it. So I just wanted to mention it in today's video as well, because I don't want others to make the same mistake. Sometimes it can be kind of hard to find like the correct perch size to coordinate and make sure it's the right size as your snake. And something that I really like that I did last time when I set up Metamora's new enclosure is I got these little bamboo sticks from Josh's Frogs, and I was able to get, I think I got like 10 of them. I got a lot of different ones. They're really skinny, but I was able to group them together to make sure that I could choose exactly how thick the perch would be to coordinate it with Metamora's body and make sure that it would fit her. So this is what hers ended up looking like. This is just 4 of them put together. And then I just tied them up at the ends, and this is a perfect size for her body right now. And those are all of the mistakes that I have for today's video. So I hope that this was helpful. It's really important to just help other people learn from mistakes that I've made in the past too. So I have no problem admitting the mistakes I've made, because we're all here to learn and just improve our care. So I hope that this can help somebody out. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you guys can come up with any other mistakes, please go ahead and leave it in a comment, and I will see you guys in the next video.